Hi, you guys. I'm not gonna keep you long. I look rough because I am recovering from strep. Hopefully, just strep. I just came from my second unholy trinity test. The first one was for COVID, flu, and strep. The second one was for my job for COVID, flu, and RSV. And I just got to thinking a series of thoughts and wanted to just share. First things first, my husband got sick. He started feeling symptoms Sunday. Monday was his birthday. And he tried to hang in there with me to do the things that I wanted to do to honor him and his birthday. And by Monday night, though, he was really sick. And then by Tuesday, he was worse. So I took him to urgent care after I got off from work Tuesday. We both got tested for COVID flu and strep. He tested positive for COVID. I tested positive for strep. But for my job's sake, like I said, I had to have another unholy trinity PCR test to make sure that I don't have any COVID mixed in there with that strep. But it got me to thinking, because taking care of my husband, I had to go from him being my very bestest friend, me being able to share and talk to him and laugh and cut up and all the things. I had to go into full caregiver mode. And he was so sick, so much pain going on. And that we didn't have that kind of interaction like we usually do on a regular. And then just now going to take the test and coming back, I thought about too, when I was full caregiver mode for my mom, along with my sisters, you know, and my daughters. But hands-on was me and my sisters taking care of my mom. And I remember when my mom was diagnosed with cancer. They didn't know exactly where it was stemming from. And so she had to have another battery of tests in Columbia. And then they finally decided it was colorectal cancer, stage 4, which most people know that stage 4 is the last stage. Most people fear that stage because it is the most deadly phase. That is where people start to go downhill. Then there are people that have stage 4 and they last a long time. Long time meaning more than a year, more than 2 years. But usually at stage 4, the cancer has ravaged the body. And I remember when she was diagnosed, I was really afraid, really scared. And those of you that don't know my mom was a prayer warrior. She was the type of person that wrote scriptures and put scriptures all over her house. So you walk in the bathroom and you have scriptures on the mirror. You call my mom and you talk to her about your problems. She's going to hear you out, talk to you. You're going to be on the phone for a little while, but she's also going to send you scriptures. And then she's going to encourage you through by sending you text messages and voice to text messages, recordings of scripture and encouragement along the way. She's also the type of person that's going to keep you accountable through the word of God. She was that person. And she thought she was slick because she'd be telling a story and then she slipped something in there like, you know Juan, my name is Tawanda. She's like, you know Juan. And she'd go in this thing and be like, but I don't want to hear that. I want you to tell me how the other person is wrong and how I'm justified in feeling how I'm feeling and stuff. But she wasn't that person. And then I went from being really afraid to being really mad. I was really mad at my mom for being sick. Yeah, let that sink in. I was mad at her for being sick, because how is it that you can be such a prayer warrior? How can it that you can be such a by the Bible book? How could you be such a person that is so honest and transparent about your past to your children and to other people? How is it that you're the type of person that can sit down and have Bible study with Jehovah's Witness and not get angry and not talk bad about them? But y'all have Bible study, not come away from it thinking that you're the top dog because you were able to show them something. But you had true Bible study with them. How is it that you're that person, but you're sick with stage 4 cancer, no less? Why can't you just get well? Why isn't your faith strong enough for you to get well? I remember that. I remember feeling like that. I remember. And I remember crying to God about that. Like, why aren't you taking her faith? And why aren't you healing her? Her of all people. And then I start naming list of people in my mind. Like, how is it that you're allowing the healing and restoration of these people, but not my mom? I was angry. I was angry at her. And I was distrusting of God. And then I remember getting to the point of saying, remembering, a thought came to my mind. Pastor Burton Ross Sr., years ago, I remember at New Life Assembly of God, and he said that when we pray, one of the things that we should pray when we're praying for other people, when we are interceding, is that we ought to pray for God's will to be done. Yes, we ought to pray for healing and restoration. We are to pray for whatever it is that their need is, for God to meet that need. But we are always to remember to pray for God's will to be done, for his plan to come into fruition. And I remember using that when a person had a question at another church that I was attending, and it was like, well, why did God let my brother, and blah, 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 blah. And I said, we have to remember that we pray for God's will to be done. That he is the author. The word says he is the author and the finisher of our faith. We don't own the faith. We have faith. And it starts as a seed, as small as a mustard seed. Like, we start by believing, and we have confidence. Our confidence grow and our trust increase in God as we have faith, and things manifest, things come into fruition. But we don't own the faith. We don't own the outcome. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. He is the beginning and the end. He knows the beginning and the end. He knows what it is that he's doing. And going back to my mom, she suffered. Not only did she have cancer. Oh, she didn't just go away quietly, you guys. Oh, no. She suffered. She suffered. We had to have a feeding tube, a TPN, and it got to where she had the surgery and her bowels twisted and nothing can go in through her intestines. And so we had bowel that we had to clean. Yeah. She wasn't getting the nutrition. But we kept the nutrition in because we wanted to keep my mom around. So, not only did she have cancer and die, but she died in a process of pain. But you know what she did do? She told us, no, she wasn't ready to die. But she trusts God. And I would come in my mom's room at the hospital and open the curtains and say, hey, you gotta have sunshine, man. Or come in the room and make sure there was sunshine coming in. But especially I remember the hospital coming in there on lunch break or after work and open up curtains. And my mom had a button, a little thing that she would squeeze to administer pain medicine. I believe it was morphine, could have been something else. A few things, and I know one was morphine because we had to get prescription morphine and fentanyl and all the other stuff. Sorry, I had a little, but she had a button, and I remember I would walk in, and she would be sitting up, bent over in her hospital bed, praying, hair wrapped up, body racking with pain, racked with pain, and she would be praying. Yep, she would be praying. So if that didn't tell me, she still had faith, but she wasn't praying for God to heal her body. She had already prayed that. She said it all the time. She wrote it all the time. She said it all the time. She was believing him. She didn't keep praying for him to heal her body. She believed him. But then she stopped praying. In with that too. But then she started highlighting for his will to be done. No, I'm not ready to die. But for his will to be done. She was praying. So I started praying for God's will to be done. And as she was praying, she would have revelations for her children. She would tell me to make sure that Tressie da-da-da, make sure CJ da-da-da, and calling Neil and da-da-da, and Chris and I. God gave me a dream and da-da-da, and somebody's having a baby. I mean, just revelation and after revelation, just truth after truth about her children over and over and over again. While she was in pain, excruciating, unnatural pain. Why am I saying all this? One is because, like I said, a series of thoughts led me to think about it. And I think it's important for us to remember we're not the owners of the outcome. But our responsibility is to keep believing God and trust Him for our confidence to grow, even in pain and even in strife and even in frustration, even when they're on your last nerve, even when you're aggravated to no end, even when you have to keep going through the uncomfortable things, for you to believe and trust God, because He is the author and the finisher of your faith. He wrote it. He knows all about it. But He also knows the plans that He has for you. He knows. And even in the good times, you got to remember, I'm going to trust Him for His plan. I'm going to trust Him for His way. Because His thoughts are much higher than mine. And His ways are far removed from what my ways are. So we got to trust and believe. And don't let nobody think, make you feel like your faith isn't strong enough when you're going through adversity, when you're going through sickness, when you're in pain, when you have the hard things to carry. You're not the author nor the finisher of your faith. God is. God alone. And we trust and believe Him, and we love Him, and we adore Him for giving us peace, for giving us strength, for giving us comfort through those things. But it's not His plan for us to have a whatever lifestyle you think when you should have the easy button versus when you have to have adversity. When adversity comes in your life. When pain is in your life. You know, because the ancestors that people on the social medias like to, Adam and Eve, that's the ancestors, okay? You know, they introduce sin. And because they introduce sin, we are susceptible to that sin. And we was born in sin and shaped in iniquity, you know? We are susceptible to that. Doesn't mean we have to succumb to it. But we're susceptible to it. We're susceptible to the diseases of this life. We are open ourselves up when we live unhealthy lifestyles, okay? Let's be real. When you make unhealthy choices, your body is going to suffer the consequence. When you are inherited genetic disorders, your body is susceptible to that. Yes, keep your mind stayed on Christ and keep giving your body to be a temple. But also remember, you're not the author of your faith. You're not the author or the finisher of your faith. and you can't dictate the outcome. I have so many different examples in my life, but that's the one that came to mind. So, shout out to God. Shout out to the author and the finisher of my faith. And, just was thinking. Just thinking out loud. And if you hear music in the background, I don't own the copyrights to that music or the radio station, man. Just wanted to share.